Good morning. The psalmist David wrote, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay. He set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. He's put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Didn't that sound good? Praise to our God. Many will see it in fear and will trust in the Lord. Isn't it great to be able to come this morning and realize that God picked us up out of the deep miry clay, set our feet on the rock to stay, puts a song in our soul today? That sounds like a song that we might sing sometime. Anyway, that's where it came from a song. A few thousand years ago. God knows what he's doing. It's still the same. He wants us to seek him, celebrate him, and serve him. So welcome to the Brazil Church of the Nazarene, because that's what we want to do today, worship the Lord. Those of you that are watching online, if you want to pick up some communion stuff around your house, because we're going to have communion later in the service. So, all right, God bless you. Let's worship the Lord.
Everybody stand.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. The King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. Heavenly Father, we invite your presence into this service this day, for you are worthy. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. I'm praising my Savior. Your name is
10,000 reasons to celebrate and worship Jesus Christ. And so let's turn to Psalm 51. This is the 10,001 reason. Psalm 51, as we stand, not doing all the verses, it's an awesome psalm. David writes, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I acknowledge my transgressions. And my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge? Behold," well, I'm skipping down to verse 7. "Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Oh God, create in me a clean heart. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Please do not cast me away from your presence. Do not take your Holy Spirit away from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you." Lord, we just bow before you and thank you for this prayer. And Lord, there's more in this psalm, but Lord, we just want to point out that we can come to you, and you, Lord, want to help us. We ask that you will help us in this service today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. We have been talking about going all in our relationship with Jesus Christ. A few of you have even contacted me and said, "I'm all in." Text message or talking to me in person. You see, going all in, we know that's real because there's an upward call of God in Christ Jesus. In Philippians, Paul writes that. It pulls us. It pulls on my heart and on your mind. It reminds us that we can do better spiritually, that we can go deeper in our relationship with God, that while other Christians wade in the shallows, that you feel this tug from God to say, "I just need to immerse myself in more of you, God. I just want to go everywhere you want me to go and do anything that you want me to do. I just want to be all in, over my head, swimming in this thing that God has for me in my spiritual walk with you. I want God's love. I want God's will for my life." This upward call of God to the deeper life means, Paul said, that there's some things we need to forget that are behind and reach forward to what's ahead. So we must let go of some things that are going to hinder our relationship, destroy even our relationship with God. So dabbling in personal sin is the biggest barrier to going all in for Christ, because Satan doesn't care what it takes, but if he can keep you down by telling you how a terrible person you are because some sins that you have committed, then he knows you're not all in. The story of David has always intrigued me. God was a part of his life from a very young age. With God's help, as a teenager, he killed a lion and a bear. That's not on too many people's resume. And then he went against this 9-foot giant named Goliath and took him out for victory for all of Israel. That got him the attention of the king, and so he began to work some in the kingdom. And that was because he was a gifted musician and a singer. He wrote many of the Psalms. A lot of that is about being chased around by enemies like Saul and Absalom and others, and his struggles and his personal relationship with God and his ups and downs and his questions. Eventually, he rose to the top position of his day. He became king over an entire nation. He defeated with his armies many nations around them with God's help. But then we have this change in his life, the time when he fell. Through lust, adultery, an attempted cover-up, and even an arranged murder, David was destroyed by sin. The songwriter, the singer, the one who could defeat Goliath was brought down. He was brought down by pornography. He looked at a naked woman who was not his. And lust began to develop. And that's what destroyed him, just as it's destroying many people today. Starts out small. And David fell. Terrible, tragic time in his life. And it took some time. Quite a period of time, in fact. It took the death of that baby. It took confrontation by the prophet Nathan. It took writing this gospel, this poem, this prayer in the depths of his heart. He's saying, God, wash me, cleanse me. David repented. There's part of here where he says, deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, oh God. I mean, he's right here. He's dealing with all these issues. This is what I did. Forgive me. This is this prayer of repentance. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my sin. Cleanse me from my iniquity. And God heard David's prayer. And God extended his grace to David. And God restored him back into a real relationship with God. If David, being where he was, could leave his relationship with God and commit a sin, more than one, then so can you and I. I know of many Christians who have ongoing battles with sin. Anybody who is honest in this room would have to say that they have had sin in their lives. We do well for a while. We're going along, we're trying to obey God, we think we're all in, and then all of a sudden a friend calls up, or someone comes by. Hey, let's go party, let's do this, let's have that. And away you go. And before the night's over, sin has taken place. For others, it's a bad week, a discouraging month, issues in your life. Things are compounding, things are getting worse, and all of a sudden, you don't know what to do. You're frustrated, you're depressed, you're discouraged. So what happens? You go back to that old habit. You go back to what you think will give you to drown it out, to get the voice, to stop the fussing and the worrying and the battle in the mind. What's familiar? Well, it satisfies maybe for a moment, but the problem is still there. Only now you have less money and more regrets. And then conviction comes, then repentance, straightening up, until the next temptation or tragedy comes along. You see, there's this upward call of God that pulls us up. It keeps saying, we can do better. There's a better way to live. There's a way to break free from this cycle. A deep diving Christian has to break free from this ups and downs, back and forth. This is not God's will and plan. His people should not be frustrated. God wants us to defeat sin once and for all. And this psalm is one way to pray to defeat sin. Let's talk about this sinful life here for a moment, because let's start with this fact. Sin has infected our world. It has infected our world. For David, it was a lustful look. He had no intention. She had no intention. But there it was. It happened. And then the infection destroyed him. You need to understand that we live in an environment in this world since the fall that there is sin all around us. There is a devil who wants to destroy you and me. His whole goal in life is to keep us away from that upward call. His goal is to cause us to sin. He's an expert at it because he did it himself. You remember, it wasn't but 3 years ago we heard about this new infection, this virus. We've gotten so over it now that even when they keep bringing it up, we just kind of... But for a while there, it was our life. And how quickly that virus spread and brought panic and disrupted normal people. Everything stopped. That's how Christian life is infected by sin. You never know how far the changes you're going to have to make, how life as you know it will stop because of sin. Your life takes place in a community that is totally infected by this virus, by the consequences of human sinful actions. It has spread everywhere. Everyone gets touched by it. Contaminated this entire world. And you have not been immune. You have been infected by sin. Everyone in this congregation has committed sins. While we rationalize our own sins, we tend to condemn the sins of others. Well, I wasn't a David. I didn't commit murder. But it's still sin. Others look at your life and they call you a hypocrite. We do that in the church. And people in the world look at the church and call us hypocrites because they know that we have sinned as well. They've seen our faults and our failures. Well, if you're just all that big of a Christian, then why did you do that? So they call us hypocrites while ignoring their own failures. The Bible says very clearly we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So instead of sitting in here being all holier than thou, we ought to sit in here and say, welcome to the bunch. We've all been there. One thing I've learned from Emmaus is that, and I've known this all along, every person has a story. Every person has a story of the time when they messed up and the time God picked them up. Amen. Every person. Part of your story includes participating in sin. But that is not where God wants you and I to live. Jesus died so that sin will not have control over us. We can be free from sin. Read Paul's letters. I mean, he's pretty dominant on this issue. Whom the Son sets free, he's free indeed. Sin should not reign over you anymore. He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. Jesus died for this. So we are to name our sin or sins, confess each one that drags us down, get victory over that sin through the power of Jesus Christ. Greater is he that lives in you now than he that's in the world. You have the right for every temptation. I will make a way of escape. So I'm trying to tell you, Christians, if you're doing this with the sin thing, God wants to set you free. Bible has hundreds of verses about sin. Oh, I hate to talk about each one, but for one of the talks at Emmaus, I compiled the lists of sin. You know, Paul is great on writing lists of sins, and there's even a list in the Old Testament in Proverbs. There are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him: haughty eyes, lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil. Okay. Just watch your news. A false witness who pours out lies, and a person who stirs up conflict in the community. Oh, I wonder if we've got any of that going on in our world. Paul says, do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral or idolaters or adulterers or men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. I'm not making this up. That's Corinthians. In Galatians, the acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, those who live in this will not inherit the kingdom of God. He wrote to the church at Ephesus, to church people. He said, but among you there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people, nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, coarse jesting, which are out of place, but rather should be thanksgiving. For this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such as that person's an idolater, shall have any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. To the Colossians, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge of the image of its creator. When we were doing 2 Timothy, there was another list there. I'm not going to read it. It's just, this world is infected. And the sad thing is Christians begin to make excuses. When a family member does it, it's okay. When I do it, it's okay, but you better not do it. Like this terrible virus, sin has infected our world, its pull is strong, and the consequences of it are everywhere. It's destroying us, literally. And that's my second point, because sin hurts. Christians, we love to talk about love. Maybe we'll get to that next week. But we have to start here by unloading the hate. See, every Christian, every person was designed by God to give and receive love. We know that. But what happens when we sin? Sin always destroys love. Have you seen the face of that person that you hurt? Can you recall that to your mind? I can. The person, not only God, but that person that I hurt by my sin. A relationship that was destroyed. Sin hurts everyone that we love. Almost every sin hurts another person. Usually the one that you love the most, I think of David. They lost their child. He forced himself on this girl. What kind of a relationship did they start out with? Try to build a marriage out of that. Sin hurts other people. But I want to tell you something that may surprise you. Every sin hurts God. Here in this psalm, David says, against you, he's praying, against you, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight. You, God, I sinned against you. I hurt you. You were my friend. You helped me to defeat Goliath. You helped me to run and survive when Saul was chasing me all over the wilderness. You made me king. You blessed our efforts in destroying enemy armies. You were part of my life. And I broke that relationship with you. Against you I sinned. All sin is resisting the authority of God's will for your life. It's saying, I don't care what you got. I don't care about your book and its rules. I don't care. I want to go my own way and do my own thing. Bam, God, I don't care. If only we could see that. It's not bad enough to see the hurt in the face of your spouse or your friend or your coworker or whatever, but you hurt God. His expression is the same as theirs, only worse, because he died for you. Every sin is a slap in the face of God. It's rebellion against God's plan for your life. It is a destruction of your relationship with a loving God who sent Jesus to die for your sins. What else could God do? Every sin hurts God. Many of the sins hurts other people. But every sin hurts yourself. Sin warps and twists you inside. It causes spiritual blindness. It brings bitterness and shame and depression and self-hatred. And over time, sin makes you hard and calloused. Against the pain you've caused God, against the pain you've caused others, and the pain that you have done to yourself. Sin is everywhere. Sin hurts. Who's to blame? When Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, they were confronted by God, and the blame game began, and it has never stopped. Adam blames Eve. Eve blames the serpent. Both of them are blaming God. You gave me this wife. You gave me, you put that serpent there. You know, it just blame, blame, blame. See, we are quick to blame life's problems and other people and peer pressure and Satan and even God for our sins. It's everybody's fault, not mine. I just walk through life and sin dumped on me and I can't help it. While there are many influencers to sin, the bottom line, and there's many of them, and I understand it's there, it's peer pressure, it's out there, it's pleasure, it's all of that. But the bottom line has always been that my acts of sin have been come because of my personal choices. You see, the word sin has a big I in the middle of it. It's S-I-N, because in the middle of it, there is I. I am the reason for my sins. David prayed in verse 3, "For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me." In the night, there it was. This is what I did. In the morning, there it was. He tries to pray. Every day as he walks by the grave of that baby and his wife's first husband that he had killed. We would like to blame others, but the biblical truth is that each of us is accountable for our own sins. I'm to blame for mine. You're to blame for yours. It is my rebellion against God's will. It is my choice to aim in the wrong target by saying, oh, I want to go this direction. God's saying, no, this is where you should go. It's my problem, my decision to hurt God, myself, and others, my selfish desire that caused me to say I will do it even though it is wrong. And there's a huge lie of Satan that makes you think that you can control your sin. Satan says, you're not like King David. You'll never commit adultery. You'll never commit murder. You're never going to do that. And you say, I'm not. But that doesn't mean that that smaller sin is any less deadly. We always think with the devil, we can cut it off. I can stop any time. I can quit looking at that. I can quit going hanging out. I can do it any time. I'm never going to allow it to get to the point where it destroys me or injures those that I love or gets me kicked out of work or puts me in jail. I'm never going to go that far. The big lie says you're smarter than everyone else when it comes to sin. You can handle it. You can control it. And you can pray anytime you want, and God will forgive you. Because you know your own boundaries. But I have found in my personal life, as you have as well, I hope, that sin is very powerful and strong. And sin and addiction cannot be controlled by my willpower alone. Why do you think the AAs and the NAs and all that start with this first line, that I need a higher power? There's got to be somebody outside of me, something bigger and better that I can ascribe to that will help me. And they won't define it as Jesus, but we will. Because you can't control everything by your willpower at all, alone. You will not walk away from your sins unless God, the higher power, intervenes in your life. And I won't either. Why are you saying these things, Pastor? Because I have been there. Oh, you don't know where I have been. You don't know. You don't know my addictions. You don't know my faults. And it's not right for you even to think to judge me because you have your own problems. But I can tell you for this, there is a God. No matter how far you go, he has an arm that reaches deeper. And he will do anything to pick you up. Anything. If you will let him. Sin is everywhere. Sin hurts. I'm to blame for my sin, but that's not the end of the story because repentance and grace brings restoration. David prayed to God for restoration. Create in me a clean heart. Renew a steadfast spirit. Do not cast me away from your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Uphold me by your generous spirit. God, change me. Wash me. Purge me. Create in me, renew in me, restore me. No doubt you've repented of your sins when you got saved. And then when you fell since then, you've had to repent. I don't know of any Christian who made the one trip and never went back. If they lived any period of time at all, somewhere along the line, they learned the hard way that there's some things in your life you just can't go there. There's some things in your life you can't touch that. There's some things you can't look at. There's some places that you... Because you've walked down that road before, you fell into that hole before, and now you just need to walk down a different road because you're tired of digging out of the same hole. Amen. And we've got an advantage over David. I keep pointing to the cross. That's our advantage. David had to ask God to forgive him of his sins, not knowing that Jesus was coming to die on the cross for his sins. He didn't even understand that yet. He knew that God was his Savior, but he didn't know how it was going to happen. And we have that advantage. You see, the place of repentance is at the cross. It is at the cross, remembering that Jesus died for you and asking him for His forgiveness, repenting of your sins, that you will continue to overcome. You will continue to defeat any sins, any habits that start to drag you down spiritually. And if you ever sin again, return to the cross. Confess your sin. Beg God to forgive you. And he loves to do that. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to a place of repentance. That is his will for you. So if you've ever sinned, come back to the cross. Ask his forgiveness. And they are covered by the blood. They are covered by the blood. Woo! It's also there at the cross we find God's grace. Every time God forgives us, we receive what we do not deserve. That's grace. A new beginning, another chance to get it right. That is grace. Sometimes we receive grace from people who we've hurt, and they give us another chance, get us back into their life. That's grace. God allows that to happen over and over. That's grace. God loves to restore us. He's very good at it. So we can be restored to God. But I want to sidetrack here. What about restoration with other people? I had a dear man that came into my life. He had sinned. The church had turned on him. He came back and was restored. He came to me with tears in his eyes. Why won't my church accept me? He said, Galatians 6:1 says, if brethren, if a man is overtaken in a fault or a trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourselves, let you also be tempted. And he said, why won't they restore me? Ended up moving away from that church to another church, where he's accepted, and he's co-teaching a Sunday school class today. But why? Why is it that that church wouldn't let him back? I know I sinned. I know I repented. I know God forgave me. Why don't my church friends forgive me? Sad to say, David wouldn't be welcome in some of our churches today. He committed adultery. He committed murder. He's not welcome here. We're better than that. Oh, yeah? What did you do? You put Jesus on the cross just as David did. He died for your sins as well. So this is no time to be sitting here categorizing sins. Well, David's way out there. God restored David. God restores us. But there's a lot of hurting people out there that haven't yet been restored. I didn't have an answer for that man. Sadly, I've been disappointed by judgmental Christians as well. This man moved on to another church. God restores. Some Christians don't, but many of them do. If you can find your life in Psalm 51, then you're going to be easier to restore someone else who finds themselves praying Psalm 51. We realize today that God has given us multiple chances, multiple restorations. And so when we come from that mindset, it's easier to have grace towards others who have fallen and are getting back up spiritually. In Galatians 6:1, it says, you who are spiritual, restore such a one. But Galatians 6:2 says, bear you one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. It doesn't say judge. It says bear. See, we've been talking about going all in. And this is the negative side of going all in. You can't go all in into what God wants in your life if you still have chains of sin holding you back. That old ball and chain every time you try to take the shackles. How many songs have we sung here in this church about breaking the chains? We sing it, we rejoice, we raise our hands, but yet we walk out of church carrying our chain. When God wants to set you free. And I don't know who you are here today, and it probably was 2 weeks ago you didn't have a problem, but today maybe you do have a problem. Maybe there's a chain that got wrapped around you this week. Things happen, circumstances change. I don't know. You gave up for a moment. You gave in for a moment. But I'm telling you, God wants to set you free. And if you're free today and you're fine, next week it's going to be your temptation. Because I don't care what age you are in life, the devil still attacks. Just ask Mildred. Just ask Barb. Just ask any of these older adults. Does the devil still fight? Does he still try to make me give up? And I tell you, he attacks me. I'm never good enough. I don't pray enough. I'm not spiritual enough. I might as well quit. I might as well give in. I might as well. Why do we even preach this stuff? He knows he can't trip me up into something really bad, like murder. But he knows he can get my attitude so. The thought, an intent of the heart may be anger, which could lead to murder. We're so quick to excuse our own. Oh, that's just my personality or whatever the case may be. But the devil plays on that to pull you down. I tell you, you need to declare war on Satan today. It's about time to get those bolt cutters out and ask God somehow, here, take these and cut me free. In the name of Jesus. Wash me, cleanse me, purge me, renew me, restore me, make me what you want me to be. Wash away my blood guiltiness. Make me a child of God again. So we're talking about going all in. You can't dive in to the deep with God with chains holding you back. And I realize our sin is not as bad as David's. But this is not a comparison of your sin against the worst sins ever. It's a question of what is holding you back from going all in for Christ. It may be an attitude. It may be a small little thing. It may be a little tiny lie. I don't know what it is. But it's keeping you from giving everything to God. Keep asking myself, why would anyone resist this upward call of God? He just wants to improve. He just wants to help. He just wants to give you more grace. He just wants you to be better than you were. He just wants to call you upward another step toward being Christ-like. Why would anybody resist that? Don't we want to be a better person? Don't we want to live for Jesus? Isn't it time to really mind God? I want to be more like Jesus. We sing these songs and then excuse our thing, our chain. I know you want to live for Jesus. I know down heart you do. And I know God wants you to live for Him. So I'm asking my friends here today, you've been where I've been. You still face it sometimes. The devil probably attacked you this week. If you resisted him, you did it through the power of God and His Word. If you gave in, it's time to kick the devil back out. It can happen in a moment of time. So God wants to meet with you at a family altar time. And instead of just bringing the same chain over and over again, why don't you tell him, let's get rid of the chain this morning, God. And I tell you, there's some people here that will help lift that burden. They're not going to count it against you. They're going to come alongside you and say, we love you. We want you to be a part of it. We want you to go all in. We want you to have everything God died for you to have. There's some people here that would do anything for you to help you keep that chain, but he's the one that's got to break it. You get it broken, and then you find a couple of weirdos to come alongside you and keep it broke. Amen? Call up that girlfriend and say, I need prayer right now. I'm being tempted. And they'll pray for you and tell you, don't do it. But you call on God and he'll say, don't do it. That's still a small voice. You'll know. You know. Family altar time, we come and talk to God about anything and everything. We've got a lot of sick people. We've got a lot of hurting people right now. I know there's a lot to pray about. But somewhere in the midst of those who come and pray for themselves and others this morning, I want you to come and carry that chain and ask God to break it, cut it, release you, set you free. That's what God wants to do for you this morning. As the praise team gets ready to lead us in the family altar time, let's just pause for a moment and ask God, Lord, this is your time. This is an age-old little sermon that has been preached every church, every pulpit, many, many times about how we need to get rid of sin and find grace and forgiveness through Jesus Christ. This is not anything new, but this is real. This is where we live. This is where our world is. And so, Lord, if we're going to go all in with you, we've got to stop playing games with our little pet little sins and keep them around while they nip at our heels and we feed them our scraps and keep them around, Lord. Help us to get rid of them. Help us to kick them off. Get rid of Satan. Get rid of the old serpent today. We pray out of our lives. We're tired of his slithering little voice. Keeps calling us back. Lord, would you do us a favor this morning? Would you come in and break some chains and kick the devil out of some lives? I pray, Lord, that you would do it in the name of Jesus. Lord, for my friends here today, give them freedom in Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. So you stand as they sing. Please come and talk to the Lord.
Shed for me, and that.
Come and pray with those that are praying, or come and pray for someone you know who needs Jesus. Let's keep the prayer going this morning, because God wants to set us free and the devil wants to keep us bound. So find somebody to pray with or to pray for. Lord Jesus, we are grateful that you died for us. Oh God, we are so grateful that you died for us to set us free from sin. Oh God, you want us to be victorious. You call us to be victorious. Lord, you don't want the devil to get an inch in our lives, but he's everywhere around us. So keep him out of our hearts. Keep him out of our minds. Protect our thoughts. Lord, keep our attitudes clear. Lord, help us to think and focus on good things. And help these young people, Lord, as they face school. And help them, Lord, these younger adults as they face work and an environment that is so anti-God. Help them to stand inside and know that God is living in them. Make them strong, Lord Jesus, we pray, to resist Satan and temptation, to be the Christian they need to be. And help them, Lord, to have verses of Scripture in their mind to think about while they're being tempted, or while they're being bothered, or while sin is going on around them. Help them to stand fast on the Word of God. We pray, Lord, that you'll so surround us, that you'll so bathe us with your love and your grace and your mercy, that we will realize we don't ever want to touch it again. We don't ever want to go there again. We don't want to say that again. We don't want to hurt our family again. Lord, we don't want to hurt you again, Lord. We don't even want to be unfaithful to ourselves anymore. We want God to set us free. Set us free, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Lord, we pray for our lost loved ones today. Every prayer group that we have here at the church, they pray for lost loved ones because we all have someone that needs Jesus in our family. And Lord, we just lift them up to you today. And we pray that you will touch and help them to come to a place of repentance, come to the cross, to lay down their burdens and accept Jesus as their Savior. We also would pray, Lord, today for some of our elders who are, Lord, facing some terrible things in their life physically. And I pray that even while they're facing these pains and these hurts and these problems, and Lord, that you would give them your presence, that you would help them to realize that you love them, that you would be so close to them right now. Oh, God, would you help them to be so close to you, and may they feel the presence and the closeness of God. And Lord Jesus, remind them that you love them, that you'll never leave them or forsake them. Guide them across the veil into what's the next in their lives. Restore those you want to restore. Heal those you want to heal, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. And for that one who's watching online that's all, Lord, overwhelmed right now, would you help them to find freedom in Christ? Help them, Lord, to give their burdens to Christ. Help them, Lord, to surrender their problems to you. And Jesus, we pray for healing and hope and help. And Lord, a new beginning. And Lord, we pray for a new refresh start in that home, in that life. We pray, Lord, that you will protect us from the evil one. Put a protection around us, we pray. And every time we're tempted, show us the way away. Show us how to get out of there. Show us how to hold our head up high and say no. Make us stronger than the problems around us, we pray. And Lord, may we be the light in that place of darkness that people will say, I want to be like you. I want to be like Jesus. Lord, make us stronger. Make us bolder. We love you, Lord. Thank you for the cross today. Thank you, Lord, for the cross. Thank you for dying for our sins. Thank you for our church family today. Thank you, Lord, for brothers and sisters in Christ who come along at any time, will help us and grow with us and encourage us. And thank you, Lord, that you are God and Satan is not God. He's just a liar. He's just a liar. He's a sneak. He's a thief. He's a tyrant. But you, Lord, are God. You are King of Kings. You're Lord of Lords. You're the master of it all, the creator of the universe. And the devil's going to bow before you, and he's going to finish in hell. He's going to finish in hell. I read it this week or last week to someone. He's going to finish in hell. Lord, we don't want to join him there. We want to be with you in heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Be in our worship now. As we continue our worship time, have communion, and walk out of here, Lord, refreshed and encouraged because of being in the house of the Lord. Lord, we hear your upward call. We're walking upward today. We're taking another step. We're going closer to you. Thank you. We worship you in Jesus' name. Pray as long as you need to, guys. Keep praying.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. That makes me white as snow. No. nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing is my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
We're going to receive the communion in just a moment, but I do want to say just a couple words here. First of all, I want to thank the pastor for the message we heard this morning, and I want to say, beloved, that there's good news. There's good news for all that we might do, as we sang about it, the blood of Jesus will take care of it. And I say this each time, but I want us to understand that you don't have to be a member of this church to receive the communion services and the bread and the wine emblem. And so, to me, that's good news. And so, if you have your elements, we will open them up and receive the communion services. And when the scripture tells us that when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And let's do that right now. Shall we do that? And he continued, and said, and in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. Let's drink, eat this, and thank God for his mercies. Let's bow our heads, shall we? Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you this morning for the truth that is found in your word. We confess to you, Lord, that we're very weak creatures. And from time to time, the enemy will come and do what he can to get us off the mark. But Lord, we thank you for the word of God that teaches us that we must put you first in our lives. And so, Father, we ask once again, as we have already taken the elements, that you would help us to remember that Jesus gave himself that we might have life. And not just life, but eternal life, and have it more abundantly. And Lord, having it more abundantly means that we can have peace, we can have contentment, we can have joy. And doesn't mean that everything's going to go smooth from now on in. We understand that. But our Father, we thank you this morning for the reality that Jesus Christ is on the throne and he's still alive. And for these things, we give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you thanks. For in all this, we say thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Mike just spoke about good news, and I have some more good news to share with you this morning. Thanks to your giving and your openness to the prompting of the Lord in your life. Last Sunday, when we collected our pledges for Faith Promise, we are very close to $8,000 in pledges, and that's a wonderful thing. If you didn't get a form for Faith Promise pledges, we have more. So they're available. And if anybody watching us online would like to give to the cause of world missions through the church, you're welcome to do that. Give us a call and we'll see that you get a pledge form, or you can just tell us whatever you're willing to do. So thank you, church, for what you've done. We give 5.5% through our church to world missions of our church income, and that is what we strive for. And anything we can give extra for that just helps us to be able to take care of those promises that we do through the Church of the Nazarene. The other good news is we've got our compassion cleaning buckets all filled and ready to go when the time comes, thanks to good helpers and your giving. That's another bit of good news that I want to give to you and thank you for. Then the other and last thing is that September is Alabaster Month. And so next week, we'll have the Alabaster Church out. And if you want an Alabaster box, see Debbie or me, and we'll see that you get one. And that also goes money to world missions. Only most of that, or a major portion of that, goes to build churches on mission fields and mission homes and that kind of thing. So thank you, church. You've been faithful, and you need to know that we appreciate all that you've done. Thank you. God bless you.
Man, you headed for heaven?
I am too.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy. trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay.
When we all
get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold.
When we all
get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Goodbye. We'll see you next week. Have a great week.